Okay, good morning, brothers. So yesterday we have seen the 24 churches, Catholic churches together make one Catholic church. So one of these 24 is Latin church, and 23 are Eastern churches, or let's say Oriental churches. So that one church we have already seen, Latin church, which is has more let's say population, let's say more number of faithful in the world, most dominating one, and the sense that in that number, number and the extension also. And now other 23 Oriental churches are there. Here we have divided into according to their status, according to their rank, we have divided here. So as I said yesterday, the first highest rank of all these churches is patriarchal churches. Then second one, major episcopal churches, which are they? Then which are the metropolitan churches? Then which are the other churches? Sui juris. This sui juris is actually supposed to be in italics. Sui juris. What is sui juris?
Self-governing.
That means they have their own law. They rule themselves. That means it's not the Roman pontiff who will be ruling them, but they have their own this one. But then, when did the, how do they come in with the Catholic Church? By accepting the primacy of a Roman pontiff, okay, successor of Peter or Bishop of Rome. Who is the second in rank? After the Latin Church, which is the other families? We have Alexandrian, Antiochian, and so on.
Byzantine.
Now let us see which are the patriarchal churches. Coptic Church, patriarchal churches are 6 in number of these 23. Coptic Church, Syriac or Syrian, what will it be? Church, Maronite Church, Armenian Church, Chaldean Church, and Melkite Church. These are the 6 patriarchal churches based on the membership. This rank is allotted to them. They belong to different families, okay, traditions. Don't think that they all belong to the one tradition. No, we are just mentioning which are of the highest rank, which are the second rank, which are the third rank, which are the other churches. The major episcopal rank is of Sri Lankara, Sri Malabar Church, Romanian Church, Ukrainian Church. These are the 4 major episcopal churches. Metropolitan churches, they are in number 5. They are in Ethiopian Church, Eritrean Church, Ruthenian Church, Slovakian Church, and Hungarian Church. Then other 8 are the other churches sui juris: Belarusian, Bulgarian, Greek Church of Croatia and Serbia, Greek Byzantine Church, Italo-Albanian Church, Albanian Church, Macedonian Church, and Russian Church. Why we mention all these church, why? They are individual churches. They are not under anybody. That's why each of them equal in rank. So each church is headed by suppose patriarchal churches are headed by, I said yesterday, patriarch. Major episcopal churches are headed by major archbishops. Metropolitan churches are headed by metropolitans. Other church series, others. Some are not dioceses even. So like that there are. Okay, we move on to the next division. These are based on the family tradition we have divided the number of the churches. Okay, this is a different type of division. Here is easy for you to know which belong to which family, which tradition, which right. Okay, that's why it is kept tradition or right or liturgical family. And under that falls in how many churches fall in that we are seeing here. So under Alexandrian tradition or Alexandrian rite, which are those churches? They are Coptic Church. Coptic Church has the status of a patriarchal church, and it came in reunion with Catholic Church in 1741. The second one is Eritrean Metropolitan Church in 2015. And then third one, Ethiopian Church, that's also a metropolitan church, came in union with Roman Catholic Church in 1846. These are the three churches having Alexandrian rite, one family. Okay, then we go up to the next one, that is Armenian tradition. Only Armenian church, which is of Patriarchate Church, then 1742 is a reunion. The next third one, as we had seen yesterday, Byzantine tradition or Greek or Constantinopolitan. All these three names, don't get confused, belong to one and the same tradition. Okay, then in that, see so many number of churches are there. Albanian, or most of these are just churches sui juris. Only a few are there of a metropolitan archiepiscopal churches, major archiepiscopal churches. Belarusian church sui juris 1596, Albanian church sui juris 1628, Greek church of Croatia and Serbia, it's also church sui juris in 1611, Greek Byzantine church sui juris 1911, Hungarian church sui juris, Metropolitan church sui juris 1912, Italo-Albanian church, it is a church sui juris in 1784, Macedonian, it's a church sui juris in 2001, and Melkite, it's a patriarchal church in 1726, Romanian church, major episcopal church sui juris 1697, Russian church sui juris 1905, Ruthenian metropolitan church sui juris 1646, in the same year another metropolitan church sui juris is Slovakian church, and then major Ukrainian church, major episcopal church in 1595. Important, either Chaldean it's called or East Syriac. Sorry, it's Syriac, it is kept. It is Syriac, S-Y, supposed to be, okay? It's also called East Syriac. See, East Syriac, West Syriac, means eastern side. Those spoke that Syriac language used in liturgy, that's East Syriac. Those towards the west, using same Syriac language in the liturgy, are called West Syriac. So from the East Syriac or Chaldean tradition, we have two churches, that is Chaldean and Syro-Malabar. They are, one is Patriarchal Church sui juris, other one is Major Episcopal Church sui juris, 1552-1599. Then we have the last family, that is Antiochian or West Syriac. And here we have three churches, Maronites, Patriarchal Church from the 4th century. This is what we said, no? They never parted with the Catholic Church. They're all always together from the beginning onwards. Then Syrian or Syriac Church, 1781, Syro-Malankara, Major Archiepiscopate, 1930. Being Indians, all of our Indians, no? Being Indians, how many churches we have in India?
Three.
So who is the head of the Syro-Malabar Church sui juris? Yeah, we know. Who is that? Cardinal Lancieri. Okay. Then Malankara? Malankara. Clemis. Clemis. Cardinal Clemis. Okay. This is only for our knowledge. It is said that Orthodox churches and Catholic churches in the apostolic faith still remain at odds. Any attempt for official reunion is still time taking. Many Orthodox churches still struggle to discover their own identity after generations of control by kings, sultans, nationalism, communism, and new emergence of evangelicalism and renewed Islamic militancy, etc. In the hope of that reconciliation, the Eastern Catholic churches can act as a bridge, a mediator between East and West. Each Eastern Catholic Church can follow their own liturgy and still can remain in communion with the Roman Pontiff. Unity is not uniformity. Unity in diversity is always appreciated in the Catholic Church. That is the strength of the Catholic Church too. So we always celebrate differences. We celebrate differences. Differences are not meant for divisions. Okay? Differences are not for divisions, but only to celebrate. See how they took part from the beginning, how some of the groups left from the Catholic Church, early Christian Church. See, each council, a few councils are there, some five or seven councils are there. So let us see, in short, what made them to go away from the Catholic Church. And since because of that, later on they realized and then they came back. Okay. Now we see first one is the Eastern Christian churches and seven councils. In the earlier days, the Christians were called as the people of the way. You know it, no?
Yes.
People of the way. Because it's a new way. They have always Jewish way only. But Christ came and started a new way. That's why they are called as people of the way. That means they are never called as Christians. Before they are called as Christians, they are called as people of the way. Okay. The way expanded mainly in five great places or centers, namely Jerusalem, the birthplace of Christianity. That's number two, Antioch. Number four, three, Alexandria. Number four, Byzantium, Constantinople, and then five, Rome. These are the main great centers of Christianity in the early days. Emperor Constantine recognized Christianity as the official religion of the empire with the, what's it, Edict of Milan, with which the five centers of Christianity evolved into five patriarchates. So each of them are called patriarchs. So patriarchates. All the Eastern churches originate from these Eastern centers, namely Antioch, Alexandria, and Byzantium. The Western Latin Rite originates from Rome. It was Emperor Constantine who renamed the Greek city of Byzantine as Constantinople in his honor. Thus, the church authority was rested with Rome, while Constantinople became the political seat of the Holy Roman Empire, because of which Constantinople became dominant patriarchy for the Eastern churches. You see, if you have noticed the map which I had showed you, in that you find what made them to come together as Eastern churches and why Rome is left alone. Due to
language,
due to geographical distance. So only Rome was left towards west, and all others are situated nearby. Alexandria, Antioch, Jerusalem, all these were situated nearby places. Only Rome was a bit far. But being a Roman Empire, all these were part of the Roman Empire at that time. So until then, in the early days, Constantine, all the Roman emperors were operating from Rome. as capital. But when Constantine became the emperor, he declared the freedom, let's say made Christianity as a state religion, and then shifted his capital towards Byzantine. Why? Because this Rome is one corner. Now we are struggling with for capital, no? This Rome is in one corner, and all other kingdoms, other things are jurisdiction is another side. So he wanted to be in the center somewhere. So that's why the biggest city in that one is Byzantine. So he chose Byzantine as his capital city. While the religion stayed in Rome, the political power shifted to Byzantine. So emperor, since he was ruling from that city, Byzantine, he named that city after his name, Constantine. No? That's why he made it Constantinople. And because it is the capital, it is the political capital, Rome remained as the religious capital. Why that? Because Rome always took the primacy of the sea. Why? Because of Peter. Because of Peter. Because Peter is the first among the equals. So since it was established by Peter, so Rome always had the primacy over other churches. But due to geographical distance, very times difficult to send the messages and so on. So slowly also, because of their own nations, because their own kingdoms, their own kings, emperors, they wanted religion under their control. So because of that, the union was not very much possible. Even you might have noticed recently, China and Vatican renewed the pact, isn't it, for 2 more years, renewed. Why? Because China wanted the appointment of the bishops. Yeah, without their knowledge, Vatican cannot appoint, it says. So that's because of the national problems within the country. So also these churches, same way. And that's how we have this political seat was, that's what we call Holy Roman Empire. Holy Roman Empire is different from the church empire. Holy Roman Empire, because it is a kingdom. Holy Roman Empire is a kingdom, it's not the church. It's a political kingdom, which is titled as the Holy Roman Empire. That's all. Don't equate the church with the Holy Roman Empire. No. That's a political entity. This is a religious entity. These two are different. Okay. The Christian churches held 7 councils to coordinate theological beliefs on the Trinity and Jesus Christ, all of which were accepted by Rome and Constantinople. These two became big ones now. Rome and Constantinople, because of Constantine, Emperor Constantine, and being the capital city of the Roman emperors, this also took prominence in the church also. So these two, always there's a communication. And then the problem were, because see, in the early days, early Christian community struggled a lot to formulate the beliefs. Struggled a lot. What we have today, the beliefs, all the dogmas, all those things, as the fruit of those early Christians and the councils. Well, we have everything is just like plate lo pettinattuga ichchaaru. Faith, no? Faith, profession of faith, we all do it, isn't it? How much they struggled to formulate that, these councils, it's really wonderful. Okay. Number one, Council of Nicaea, 325, Council of Nicaea. It declared that the Son was the same substance as the Father, and that's how it formed the Nicene Creed. Nascent means initial. Nicene Creed. We have 2 creeds now. What are they? Apostles' Creed and the Nicene Creed. Nicene notes here. Nicene Creed. Okay. So what's the difference? What's the difference? Apostles' Creed and Nicene Creed. The thing is this. Apostles, what they taught, what the apostles taught, were in that creed. Okay? That's that tablets like this. That's it. Or with that. But then those who wanted clarification, those who wanted to know, study deeper, and that's those who got the a kind of doubts and so on, clarifications and so on, then they started coming together, you know, to discuss those doubts or disbeliefs or any other interpretations, and they came together and discussed, and then they formulated a kind of a broader, longer, elaborate formulations. So dispelling all the doubts, disbeliefs, demystifying, okay, making it very clear, pointed out. And that's how Nicene Creed looks longer. So in this, Nicene Creed declared that the sun was the same substance. You have studied in Christology, I suppose. Homo usius. What does it mean? Usius means? As the father and formed the Nicene Creed. Nascent Creed. Okay, Nicene Creed. Okay. We can't talk much in this. Okay. The champion of this is Athanasius of Alexandria. He said, Christ had to be divine for our salvation and redemption. And that's how the divine nature of Jesus Christ was affirmed in this. Theology of Christian redemption started formulating. The second council, that's the Council of Constantinople, 381 AD. In this, Saint Cyril and Cappadocian fathers, they believed in homoousios for the Holy Spirit as well. Holy Spirit also has the same substance. So the first council said that Father and Son had the same substance. The second council came and said not only those two, Holy Spirit also had the same substance. And that's how Basil, Gregory of Nazianzus, and Gregory of Nyssa, these were the champions of this theory. Thus the council expanded Nicene Creed, quoting John 15:26, the Holy Spirit proceeding from the Father. That's what this they added. Number 3, Council of Ephesus. The council defined Mary as Mother of God, 431 AD. The council defined Mary as the Mother of God, which was intrinsic to the human nature of Christ. This was rejected by Nestorius and led to a Persian group that became the Assyrian Church of East. See how they started going away. The council said very clearly, Mary as the Mother of God, which was intrinsic. Understood, it's intrinsic, it's part of the human nature of Christ. So that's the reason why they could not accept, and then they went away, they left. That became Assyrian Church of the East. Fourth council was the Council of Chalcedon. It declared that Jesus was one person with two natures, divine and human, in perfect harmony. This was held by West and Byzantine Constantinople. Objection: Armenians, Syrians, Coptics, Ethiopians, and Indians still hold that Christ was one incarnate nature of the Word of God. Thus, they went away and formed the Oriental Orthodox churches. You see how the origin of these Orthodox churches means going away. What does it mean by Orthodox? See? Orthodoxy means right teaching. Docere means to teach. Doxy. Yeah? Right teaching. So we have the right teaching. We have the right belief. So they went out. This is Orthodox. Then from those Orthodox churches, Orient Orthodox churches, some came back. That's why we call it as reunion. Number 5, Council of Constantinople. Second Council of Constantinople, which took place in 553 AD. Emperor Justinian called this council. The council reaffirmed that there is one person in hypostatic union in our Lord Jesus Christ. One person, hypostatic union. Hypostatic union, what does it mean? Hypostatic union. Exactly. It's already mingled in Christ, in one person. Mingled in Christ. In one person, this union is there already, human and divine, and so on. The fifth one is over. Then we have the sixth one, that is the Third Council of Constantinople, which took place in 681 AD. In response to monothelite controversy, the Christ, monothelite means
one will.
In response to monothelite controversy that Christ had only one will, this council affirmed the efforts of Saint Maximus the Confessor, who confessed that Christ had two wills and two natural operations, divine and human in harmony. Divine and human in harmony. John chapter 6 verse 38. Please make sure scripture is the basis for everything. Scripture. It's only from the scripture they could formulate all these formulations, theories, and so on. Not away from the scripture. That's how we have the tradition, scriptural tradition we have in the church. These are not two different sources, but one source. Scripture and tradition as a one source for us, not two sources. Because everything that has come out is from the scripture. And what in the scripture also contain not only the life teachings of Jesus Christ, but also the tradition, early tradition is there. St. Paul, Acts of the Apostles, and letters, all these things are part of the early tradition. That's how scripture contains also tradition. That's how we have to respect tradition. We cannot simply say that tradition is of useless, only scripture is there. No, these two are together as one source. One source for us. Being deacons, it's good that you know all these things. Because in the examination, if you are asked, scripture and tradition, are the two sources or one? You should be able to say one, saying this explanation. Okay. So, they argued that only one will, but Saint Maximus the Confessor came and said that Christ had two wills, but always in harmony, these two. Just like in the Garden of Gethsemane, Jesus said, no, while praying to the Father, let this cup pass me by. He said it, isn't it?
Yes.
Like human being. You and I also say, when it is very hard, let this exam go away from me, Jesus. We say like this. We pray like that. But the divine will, the divinity comes later. That is, not my will, let your will be done. See that. Acceptance. That's where comes the divine aspect. Human, divine wills perfectly harmonized in Christ. Okay. Second Council of Nicaea in 787 AD. It resolved the iconoclast controversy. Iconoclast means you have studied this church history, no? Icons.
Images.
Images. Yes. No images. Outbreak. Break all the images. Controversy. With the help of the writings of St. John of Damascus, according to whom veneration of holy images of the human face of Jesus is justified, as Jesus had a true humanity and his body was finite. Because He was a human being, so it is good that we have the image of Jesus Christ. Because he is a human being, he was visible to his people of his time. He was visible. So we have no problem in having the image of Jesus Christ. Just as you and I have got our photos, pictures everywhere, isn't it? There's no problem having. Then why do we have problem of having the image of Christ? Because they were also human. He was also a human being, not just divine alone. That's what he argued. Brothers, these are the seven councils which helped formulate theological beliefs or the faith of the Catholic Church at large. How they struggled to understand all these different people, different groups, they struggled to understand. Some couldn't understand, and then they went away and formulated other churches, saying that they are right, we are wrong. By that sense. But then how the each council came out and said, declared, in spite of all these divisions, in spite of all these disputes, church always stood by the right teaching. Church always stood by this teaching. So this is what we have seen in these seven councils. Now we come back to the proper, our subject proper. So far is the background, historical sketch, and so on. Good that we know history, isn't it? Why? Because without history, no present, no future also. So that's why we should never disregard history. History is important for us to know our origins, our sources. Well, codification of Oriental Canon Law, CCEO. Please, please, please make sure that you know these terms paka. Never forget these terms. What is meant by the CIC? If it is asked, you must will say Codex Juris Canonici. What is CCEO? If it is asked, you must will say Codex Canonum Ecclesiarum Orientalium. Okay? Ecclesiarum Orientalium. Okay? Codex Canonum Ecclesiarum Orientalium. The code of canons of the Eastern churches. So that was promulgated, CIC for Latin Church, was promulgated in 1983. And then this was promulgated in 1990. Yes, we'll come back. Eastern churches have a long tradition of divine worship. So that is what we say, spiritual patrimony, divine worship. Among all the Eastern churches, there is no single form of worship. You can never say that there is a single form. Why? Because they were founded by different apostles. That's it. Different apostles. These days we have what we are doing, how we are worshipping here. We have the record, all this modern technology and so on. We live telecast elsewhere what's happening here. But those days, there wasn't anything. So geographical boundaries, geographical distance made it impossible to know each other's worship. That's what the apostle taught them, what he said and how he practiced in that church, in that society, became a norm, and that's how they developed their way of worship. So in that way we have different forms of worship. So there is no uniformity. However, all these churches, all these 23 churches are in commune with the Latin Church. For the Latin Church, CIC 1917 was the first code in the church, which was promulgated in 1917. CIC, same, Codex Juris Canonici, 1917. Its work was started by Pope Pius X, and completed by the Pope Benedict the 15th. Hence, it is also sometimes called a Pio Benedictine Code, which may not be nice, but some call, because one Pope started, other Pope completed. So they call it like that. After the Vatican II, this code was revised, updated and promulgated in 1983 by Pope John Paul II. For Orientals, there were some collections of Oriental laws which were called as Codex Iuris Canonici Orientalis. See, beginning out was Chico. Okay. Codex Iuris Canonici, up to there, CIC, no? Add one, Orientalis. It was there, like that. Some collections were there. This was the first code for Orientals, but was not promulgated as a single text. As a single code, it was never promulgated. So, it was promulgated as different motu proprios. And these are the following ones. Those following motu proprios. Motu proprio is given there. On one's own initiative. Motu proprio means Pope took the initiative. Roman Pontiff took the initiative to promulgate. So that is what is called motu proprio. Motive, one's own intention. Proprio means one's own. So on one's own initiative, on one's own motive, it was declared, promulgated. First one is CA. Not CA means not chartered accountancy, but crebre allate. That is canons on marriage. See, promulgated in 1949, effective from 1949 May. So 131 canons were promulgated on marriage. The second one, Solicitudinem Nostram, on canons on procedures. Procedure means process, no? How do you process? Any process, be it for penalties, sanctions, there should be always process. If there is no process, the judgment is invalid, no judgment, if you don't follow the process. Okay, so those on procedures, canons on procedures, 576. Postquam apostolicis literis was canons on religious, temporal goods and some main terms definitions. These are the canons. These are promulgated in 1952. And then Cleri Sanctitate. These are on rights, persons and so on. In the persons, we also have physical persons. Which are the other persons? How many types of persons are there in the court? Latin court, let us say. Physical, juridical, and not oral, moral. Moral persons. Okay, good. I think you are preparing well for the comprehensive. It's good. Okay. And once, okay, these are the ones. Then Pope Pius the 12th died. Just a minute, we'll finish. Pope Pius the 12th died before he could complete promulgated laws on sacraments and sanctions. Still more to come were sacraments and sanctions. But before that, he died. He was succeeded by Pope John the 23rd. Then he ordered for the amendments and called for Second Vatican Council. From 1965, it took 18 years for the preparation and promulgation of a Latin code. Similarly, for the promulgation of CCO, Oriental law, also took 18 years from 1972 to 1990. Thus, CCO was promulgated on October 18, 1990 by Pope John Paul II.